Welcome from me, Andrew, to the last in our Contemplating Easter series for 2022. As a foreword, this Lent we are acutely conscious of the unfolding unjust and horrific war, with millions of victims living the horror moment by moment. No reference by our contemplations can be adequate. Please accept the limitations of these thoughts in such circumstances. Our Lenten theme this year is a journey back home, in the sense of back to God. For many, their Lent reality is characterised by loss of physical home and citizenship. It still profoundly exists for each person, carried deeply within, but they are physically dispossessed of it. In Lent, we turn our eyes upon Jesus, straining for the way, truth and life he demonstrates, seeking to reconcile our citizenship of earth and heaven. Picking up the story in Gethsemane, we look at the trial passages. These are too long to include in full today, but extracts will be read, taken from Matthew 26:47 to 27:31 and John 18. In summary, our three sessions dwell on Jesus and citizenship, specifically Jesus and the Sanhedrin, the religious authority, Jesus and Pilate, the political authority, and Jesus and three gardens, our heavenly authority. There will be pauses for reflection as usual, and you might like to light a candle or place a cross where you can see it, if it helps with your focus. So let us commit our time together to the Lord with a prayer. Bless us, Lord, with vision. May this place be a sacred place where heaven and earth meet. Amen. Session 1, Jesus and the Sanhedrin. In Gethsemane, which means the garden of the oil press, in the moments just before his arrest, Jesus foresaw the crushing weight of the burden he must bear. Matthew 26, verse 47 tells us, "And while he was still speaking, behold, Judas, one of the 12, with a great multitude with swords and clubs, came from the chief priests and elders of the people." After his arrest, Jesus and his surrounding clamour proceed into the night hours of Passover, on the way to the chicanery of the trials that awaiting him. In Lent, we may be tempted to dwell on self-examination of our own continuing part in his unjust treatment. Instead, Jesus teaches us much by observing how he is in his example of personal conduct. Who are the players in our drama, perhaps best described collectively as citizens? We have Jesus' disciples, who are his friends, and those welcoming his teaching. The Sanhedrin, temple officials and ruling council, often offended at perceived criticism of their methods of administrating power through religion. The Roman imperial authorities, highly suspicious of potential challenge to their political power. And the great multitude, or ordinary crowd, armed and roused by the extraordinary, or the incomprehensible. Friends, church, politicians, community, the model of citizenship, then and now. And always in the midst of the citizens, then as now, is Jesus the man, also deeply challenged by questions of citizenship of earth and heaven, just like us. As we look past the clamour at Jesus' actions, we see the instinctive way he first gives of himself totally, restoratively. For example, he knows the motivation for his betrayer's greeting kiss, yet still includes him as friend. He diffuses his disciples' futile sword strike, knowing angelic hosts could help if needed, instead healing the wounded ear of the aggressor. By his cooperation, he brings light to the clandestine and aggressive arrest. He, the living word, true to the prophets, cares for his disciples despite their forsaking of him. So Jesus leaves the garden, peacefully but resolutely descending the hill to Jerusalem to face the Sanhedrin. The Sanhedrin's prime responsibility should have been as guardians of Jewish law in matters of religious, civil, or criminal jurisdiction. Yet this kangaroo court was contrary to Jewish law on multiple grounds, such as false witnessing, illegal time and place, incorrect evidence, and disregard of proper procedures. How does Jesus act in the face of such blatant irregularity? From Matthew 26, verses 62 to 64. And the high priest arose and said to him, "Do you answer nothing? What is it these men testify against you?" But Jesus kept silent. And the high priest answered and said to him, "I adjure you under oath by the living God, tell us if you are the Christ, the Son of God." Jesus said to him, "It is as you said. Nevertheless, I say to you, hereafter you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the power and coming on the clouds of heaven." I want to highlight three observations about Jesus' response. Firstly, Jesus kept silent. Of all the defences available, he chose the way of silence, avoiding pointless debate with the dust of misrepresentation and untruth. Secondly, in proper obedience to the high priest's authority and answering Caiaphas's only real question, Jesus finally reveals the real truth. "It is as you said," thereby exposing the futility of their scheming, as if to say, "You only had to ask, and by implication, listen to the answer." And thirdly, Jesus adds a sober prophetic reminder to Caiaphas that how he uses his high priestly power with the accused Son of God standing before him is precisely the same as if Caiaphas were standing before the unseen power in heaven. Well, sadly, Caiaphas does not listen. By power-mongering, he has the temporal victory he desires, inciting his council to condemn Jesus worthy of death for blasphemy, thereby implicating them in his decision. Compounding their error, they brutally humiliate Jesus with spitting, beating, slapping, and mocking. Finally, they reconvene at first light to concoct a false political charge from an illegal religious charge that Pilate may be manipulated into delivering a death sentence. Coming to our first pause for reflection, we are reminded how abuse of authority remains ever present. We encounter it personally and in global reports, particularly of Ukraine at this time, but conscious that much also goes unreported. Our intention, though, is to look to Jesus, always amid the citizens, to observe the loving choices he exercises on the way through the trials before him. These include friendship for betrayal, cooperation for provocation, laying down weapons, healing the wounded, the light of honesty in the dark of secrecy, silent restraint for hectoring aggression, righteous obedience to abusive authority, truth for deception, including prophetic warning. You may wish to take a few moments of quiet to reflect. If so, please press the pause button and continue with the contemplation when you are ready. Our prayer may simply cry out for Jesus' way to find a growing presence at the heart of the chaos of war. Session 2, Jesus and Pilate. So Jesus stands before Pilate, accused by the Jewish authorities. It is John's Gospel that gives the most detail of this trial, particularly the dialogue about truth. From John 18, verses 35 to 38. Then Pilate entered the praetorium again, called Jesus, and said to him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered him, "Are you speaking for yourself on this, or did others tell you about me?" Pilate answered, "Am I a Jew? Your own nation and the chief priests have delivered you to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would fight, so that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now my kingdom is not from here." Pilate said to him, "Are you a king then?" Jesus answered, "You say rightly that I am a king. For this cause I was born, and for this cause I have come to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice." Pilate said to him, "What is truth?" And when he had said this, he went out again to the Jews and said to them, "I find no fault in him at all." Pilate's prime responsibility was political. As governor of the Roman dictatorship, his duties required him to peacekeep, by rule of Roman law, but tolerant to regional tradition, including foreign divinities, providing it did not stir up conflict. Brute force underpinned the regime, not a problem, we understand, for Pilate. Rebel factions could threaten stability, often a displaced sovereign and their supporters. So Rome legitimised any claim to kingship by dictating the kingdom's limitations, which it either accepted or perished. Such was the context of the case Pilate was called to judge by the troublesome Jews. On the grounds of sedition, they demanded a death sentence for Jesus, allegedly a troublemaker claiming to be king of the Jews. The case was poorly presented, without evidence other than the rubber stamp of the Jewish authorities, which they presumed sufficient for Pilate. Pilate very likely irritated by such presumption, not to mention insulted by their local defilement custom, decides to gather his own evidence, particularly on the issue of kingdom. It was a political cauldron, with significant political points to be scored on either side, and Jesus as the perfect pawn caught in the crossfire. So looking to Jesus, in what way does he conduct himself? Thank God Jesus is nobody's pawn. He shows no fear in the face of dictatorial power, respectful but not submissive. Again, wasting no time on the Jews' hearsay accusations about his kingdom, he redirects Pilate's attention towards the truth of who he is. Yes, he does have a kingdom, though not of this world, and therefore apparently no threat to peace, significantly for Pilate. But such otherworldly talk also engages Pilate, prompting him to imply if Jesus is a king, he doesn't look much like one. Jesus then delivers the perfect vision, mission, and values statement. Paraphrasing, the royal vision of the kingdom of truth is that he, Jesus, was born and came into the world. The royal mission of the king is to bear witness to the truth. The royal values of the citizens of the kingdom of truth are determined by hearing Jesus' voice. Jesus articulates a new citizenship founded on the power of truth without brute force. This is quite the inverse of Pilate's citizenship that is dependent on brute force for his power, with truth of little significance. Jesus has effectively preempted Pilate's job by defining Rome's limitations. Predictably, pragmatic Pilate is dismissive. What is truth? Perhaps just a cynical throwaway line. Perhaps lauding it to belittle Jesus' royal mandate. Certainly, truth has little use in Pilate's political arena. But significantly, he reports no untruth back to the Jews. I find no fault in him at all. Perhaps, for a moment, in engaging with Jesus, Pilate himself was touched by the possibility of truth, even divinity, in this otherworldly character. History reenacts this same drama endlessly, across the spectrum from global politics to the politics of individual relationships. Our drama represents every great multitude caught up with conflict over philosophy, politics, and economics. Without truth, life is shackled by Pilate's and Caiaphas's strategy of brute force winning, those losing being deprived of their true birthright. To search for truth is to reach beyond such shackles for that birthright which enables every individual the creative freedom to transcend and transform. In other words, it is a desire, our Lenten thirst, to draw closer to truth that reflects the divine, that we may grow in God's likeness. But like Pilate, how do we recognize truth? Jesus answers, "For this cause I was born, and for this cause I have come to bear witness to the truth." Through his witness, born as one of us, we hear the truth of his word and see the grace of his deeds at the heart of the throng of citizens. But do we recognize it? Echoing through the ages, Jesus gifts us that choice, saying, "Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice." This call to the truth is the call to repent and the journey back home, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Sadly, once again, as the story unfolds, the worldly powerlessness of Jesus' mandate of truth is swiftly demonstrated. Like Caiaphas, Pilate takes his eyes off Jesus' truth to the increasingly agitated chaos of the citizens. His only solution is brute force, and Jesus must bear the burden of unimaginably cruel brutality. You may wish to take another few minutes of quiet to reflect. If so, please press the pause button and continue with the contemplation when you are ready. Despite the images of violence, perhaps our prayer may simply cry out for the darkness of the chaos of the war to be set free by Jesus' truth. Session 3, Jesus and Three Gardens. So far on our Lenten journey back home, we see Jesus' loving way despite the surrounding clamour. We see him witness to the truth despite that which would render it opaque. But where is his life on the journey? The text for this final session is the single verse, John 18, verse 1. When Jesus had spoken these words, he went out with his disciples over the brook Kidron, where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Only John's Gospel refers to a garden, in contrast to Gethsemane, or the place. In so doing, John draws us deeper, recalling two other familiar gardens. The first looks back to Eden, the story of paradise and the fall, and the place of Adam and Eve's banishment through disobedience. The second anticipates the garden of the new tomb, the place of Jesus' resurrection through obedience. Between the two is the garden of Jesus' ultimate testing at the prospect of the trials before him on his journey back home. In the Garden of Eden, we find the start of a way that hankers after truth in knowledge that God did not intend for us, leading to a life of self-gratification God did not intend for us, and most likely using lives of others in ways God did not intend for them. The Garden of the New Tomb shows us the way that believes the truth of who Jesus is, and calls us to follow him home to the risen life God did intend for us. In between, the Garden of Gethsemane is the place of Jesus' agony, where he sees the accumulated horror, including our own, of that which God did not intend. The way is prepared, that he knows only he is called to tread, which is not just to bear the horror, but to become it. And he does not want to. When does Jesus ever double-check the truth of his Father's wishes? But such was his dread, he prays three times for the cup to be removed, if possible. In our pilgrimages, we may prepare ahead, but the moment always arrives when planning stops and the actual event starts in real time, the point of no turning back for every player in the drama. The garden was the place and supreme moment in time when history turned towards home. We know the outcome, of course, that in that moment Jesus chooses the risen life through the cross, obedience to his Father's will. Sure enough, right on cue, the mob of citizens arrive. The point of no turning back is past, and the real-time drama has begun. In his human dread, had Jesus chosen differently, what can we say of the crucifixion or resurrection? In this, Jesus shows us that, in prayer, it is only a moment of choice for the Father's will, and the course of history is changed. We desire Jesus' way, truth, and life in our citizenship, as if it were absent. But in fact, there is no part of our citizenship that falls outside the crucible of Jesus' statement. For each of us, our way is simply a work in progress of choices, or a pilgrim's progress, perhaps. Our truth is simply the reflection of the divine chosen through a glass darkly, to quote St. Paul. Our life is simply the imperfect product of these two sets of choices. And yet, as citizens, there is nothing simple about these choices. How representative are the citizens in our drama of communities of citizens the world over, and what do they comprise? In the Sanhedrin, we recognise religious authorities of a nation wielding the brute force of legal sticks in God's name to control and exploit their subjects rather than encourage them closer to God in their journey home. In Pilate, we recognise the political dictator wielding physical brute force in foreign lands to enslave for the earthly imperial purposes that constitute his home. The crowds are like fields of grass that sway in the winds of propaganda, unclear what home may mean and reliant on someone else to tell them. And the disciples long to be true to their brand of shepherd, herded towards the often exclusivity of their homes. We may try to imagine a perfect citizenship, cleansed of the above stumbling blocks. But truly, this is pie in the sky. The citizenship described is the only reality. It is totally mixed up, full of conflicting interests, at both the personal level as well as amongst nations, where earthly and supernatural citizenship clash. Jesus himself brings us the good news. I did not come to condemn the world, but to save it. He is at the heart of all human existence, showing a way of self-giving that cares for those caught in the crossfire, who are casualties of the conflicting interests. In his walk through the trials, remember how he gives of himself through inclusive friendship, cooperation, non-aggression, healing, honesty, silent restraint, obedience, and truth. Then we see him bear witness to the truth in two senses. Firstly, reflecting the divine in his loving actions, and secondly, in the sense of bearing the horrific weight of what the reflection of worldly truth reveals. Jesus' life was with Adam and Eve outside of the Garden of Eden. Jesus' life is in the Garden of Gethsemane, which he and his disciples entered, in the anguish of our own moment-by-moment choices for God amidst the clamour of the world's call. And Jesus' life is in the garden of the new tomb beyond the crucifixion, beckoning us home to his resurrection life, perhaps a garden of beatitudes. Please press pause again now if you would like to take a final few minutes of quiet to reflect. I am sure I am not alone in speaking of the profound presence the war has been in my Lenten journey. For every broken palace and every broken heart, we cry out for Jesus' life to save and restore the wastelands. When you are ready, please restart the recording and we can finish our contemplation with this closing prayer. Holy God, allow more and more thoughts of your thinking to come into our hearts day by day, till there shall at last be an open road between you and us, and your angels may go up and down among us, so that we may be in your heaven even while we are upon your earth. Amen. May your Easter season be blessed abundantly, and thank you for listening.